partners, welcome back to Tropical Marine Centre. Colette here. Today's video we're going to be sitting down with Brian, the CEO of Tropical Marine Centre, and we're going to be talking about ranched fish and the whole concept. So if you want to hear all about that and see the answers from Brian specifically, then please watch this video right until the very end. Or if you're on podcast, then please listen to the very end. Thank you very much everyone for listening and watching, and take care, enjoy the video. So as I said in the intro, we're here today with Brian. We're going to go over ranched fish and the whole concept and ask a few questions. So Brian, what is ranched fish?
Right, so ranched fish came as the original concept was collecting post larvae.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a new concept, it's something the industry has actually done 15, 20 years ago.
Okay.
It worked to some extent. There were some issues with the variety of species or the costs involved in setting up these facilities.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a bit of a revival of an old project.
Right.
And it, the name came up because we found that CITES actually uses different source codes. So when you import fish, CITES will say, or animal, the item can be propagated, can be captive bred, mm-hmm. can be wild, and there was this concept called ranched. And in conversation with a friend of ours in the industry, he was saying, oh, it should be, the concept you're describing is ranched. I said, okay, well,
so yeehaw.
So, and then it, you know, obviously led to, we could see some, because we wanted to make sure as well that we weren't confused with captive breeding.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily captive breeding. Mm-hmm. And we felt the first name, and the industry has used that before, called tank raised.
Yeah.
But it leads to confusion, and it's not meant to be that way. It's meant to explain, look, this is collecting post larvae. We grow it, we culture it, you know, we rear it, we help the larvae go up to the settlement stage. And so it's a much more sustainable, it's a very sustainable method.
Yeah.
But it doesn't complete the full cycle. So you let nature do what it does best.
Yeah.
And the larvae. Mm-hmm. So, you know, nature does all the larvae, does the difficult bit,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know, rear all the larvae. It's known that, you know, 99% of the larvae would die anyway. So as food mm-hmm. at that stage, so they wouldn't cross that stage, and we just help them through that final bit.
Right, so it's incredibly sustainable then in doing what we're doing.
That's the concept. And the good thing about using some of the terminology CITES uses mm-hmm. or some of the scientific terminology
mm-hmm.
is that there's a lot of literature out there about this. So we don't have to convince people that this is sustainable, though we know it is.
Yeah.
We don't have, it's not a novel, you know, idea. It's just something we, you know, adopt into our practices.
And can we talk a little bit about the process of bringing a post larvae out?
From the ocean?
Yeah, so how do we go about collecting that? What do we do?
Okay, so this is a technology developed by a company called Ecocean,
mm-hmm.
Ecocean, because they're French. Again, many, many years ago, they developed these, what they call light traps. There's a couple of types of traps that you can use.
Mm-hmm.
They primarily focus on light traps, which is massive, you know, focused type of collecting.
Right.
With a net, it's got a light on top. You can only collect certain types of days in the month.
Mm-hmm.
So, because, you know, lights are attracted to, larvae are attracted to light,
mm-hmm.
which means if it's a full moon, you're going to get a bigger dispersion of larvae, so you're not going to be able to attract larvae to your trap. So,
right.
But if you do it during a new moon cycle, and at the right times of the month and at the right times of the year,
mm-hmm.
you're going to get certain species and you're going to get a bigger concentration of larvae. There'll be nights you get one larvae, there'll be nights you don't get anything, there'll be nights you get, you know, a few hundred of the wrong species, of the right species. So it's a bit of a shot in the dark, so we're all learning about how to do that.
Yeah, that's quite interesting, that the moon cycles as well even come into play with.
Yes, and to be completely honest, we're learning from that. So not even, you know, very experienced people with technology will tell you, because it depends on which area of the planet you're in and where the tides are as well. It's a learning process. It's a very interesting process as well.
Yeah, incredibly interesting. It was very interesting to see the size that they came in the first time and then now how they've grown out just a few months later. So they're growing quick, which is great.
Yes.
So the concept for us is that we're taking them from the ocean and then we're going to have our suppliers raise them there before they then come over to us, right?
So with captive breeding, and bear in mind, we've been doing captive breeding for a few decades now.
Yeah.
And I mean, TMC did a few world firsts. We had our own hatchery. A lot of the designer clowns out there came originally from the building next to us.
But there's
always this niggle effect from captive breeding, although it's a very sustainable way to do it, is when you start with being really good at it, what happens to those people who actually depend on this natural resource at source?
Mm-hmm.
From a heritage point of view, genetically, it's their heritage. And they should be allowed to, that's a much bigger conversation than we have time today.
But, yeah.
That's related to the Nagoya Protocol. But it's important for us to be able to also ensure that our suppliers have continuity in their own businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So this ticks that box completely in a very good way, because it not only allows us to ensure a future sustainable resource,
mm-hmm.
But also allows us to support our suppliers in getting into this stage and teaching them, giving them training on how to set these collecting methods, training on how to use live foods, tanks specialized for tiny little fish, what attention to detail they need to come up with.
Mm-hmm.
And I think one of the things we see in the industry is that the population of suppliers is aging.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's more and more difficult to find, young people to come along.
Right.
Part of it because, it's fishing. It's not, it's not, is that a cool thing or is that, you know what I mean? So, but the moment you introduce a concept like this,
new concept to them,
you can see their eyes light up.
Yeah.
You can see people getting excited about it. You can see people going, I can embrace that. I would love to play a part in this for my country and to develop, agriculture methods or ranching methods in this business and develop that in the country. So I think that's quite a good positive effect of this.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the viewers' questions will be, where does it sit price point wise? So will it be cheaper than wild caught? Will it be more expensive than captive breeding? Where would it sit in that chain?
So captive breeding has always been associated with being more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
There are reasons for that. You will people have to understand that setting up a hatchery for a species is a very expensive thing to do and to run it as well,
mm-hmm.
especially in the countries where we're running those, people are running those.
Mm-hmm.
And so they attract a premium. So if you culture 50, 100 items of a single species and you calculate backwards all the costs you've had with that,
mm-hmm.
You're never gonna make it back. So you need to, it's a balance between volume and costs.
Yeah.
But it still is something that attracts a premium. It usually sits around 20-30% more than wild.
Mm-hmm.
With ranching, we didn't really know what to do because, so we went back to basics and said, okay, how much is this realistically costing us to the supplier in terms of manpower, in terms of facilities, investment, return on investment, and then also looking at freight, because freight is also slightly different, and how much is it landing here, how long do we need to keep them, we costed the whole thing out.
Yeah.
What that means is that the cost structure of these fish is going to be completely different.
Mm-hmm.
So, whereas, so let's say a fish comes in, if we've got a lot of a specific species, mm-hmm. You have to go back to supply and demand. So if you've got a lot of, you know, specific damsel, because within that moon cycle that was being recruited on the reef, you're going to get thousands and thousands of those potentially. So the price can't be very high. So we basically introduced a lower price than wild, mm-hmm. a much lower price than wild.
Right.
Than normal is.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a very rare item, mm-hmm. Then you can also say, okay, can we match wild or mm-hmm. or be even slightly under, but not half price? So it's because it's a rarer thing. So it's we only have one or two, and that will attract a lot of demand mm-hmm. for that one tang or that one butterfly or those 10 angels that you've managed to ranch. So there'll be a lot of demand, but very, you know, not much supply. Mm-hmm. So you're going to have to adjust the price for that.
Yeah, and it'll balance out.
But I don't think, look, the idea is not to make it very expensive. Mm-hmm. One of the matters we're trying to resolve in the industry is costs are going through the roof. And the more the costs go up, the less volume the industry will be. Because it basically, you know, prices people out of the market.
Mm-hmm.
So bringing back down some of these costs is quite important for us.
It's great to hear, because I'm sure the viewers will also be happy to go into a fish shop and ask for a range of fish knowing that as well.
Yes.
So
should be less expensive.
Yeah. The other question I think that they'll be asking will be, is it a lottery? And I guess the answer is yes to that.
If you see projects around the world that say, oh, we ranch this specific species,
mm-hmm.
I don't know how they do it. Because when you're fishing, when you're going out, even if you know that specific species is recruiting in that location and in those oceans, the world is a very vast place. So you basically, if you think about the science behind it, the fish, you know, lays their eggs, larvae, you know, hatch, and they, you know, they basically go on to open ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And they disperse themselves into hundreds of, you know, thousands of meters in that reef. When they come back to the reef on that night,
mm-hmm.
You'll get one or two of each species, or maybe there's a little group that are swimming together, but they're larvae, they're free swimming. So it's difficult to say it's going to be targeted to that specific species. So you're going to get a mix of everything.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in some of the first catches, we got 20, 25 species on one catch.
Wow.
And you go, okay, what are they? And then you can't identify them as well on the day of the catch because they're all transparent and they're all, you know,
tiny.
But some of them are quite big, but it's, what is it? They look like little aliens. They don't even resemble the adult form. So there are guides which we've been learning about and, you know, trying to complete with the experts in this.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have to keep them for a number of days. They then settle,
right.
And then you identify. Oh, okay. Well, that's going to grow very big. So I can't, you know, we can't, we have to grow it a certain size and, you know, and release it.
Yeah.
Or, you know, there were nights we only collected worms.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, what on earth is that?
Worms.
Worms. And it's like, okay, well,
can't do anything with that.
All goes back, so it's an evolving process. So there are species that, I mean, you can't keep in captivity. So that all has to. So especially in these, in some of the oceans, these are very productive oceans and with a huge variety of species. And it's, you know, it's so we have to target those. We have to then learn. Okay, these are damsels. These are surgeon fish. These are butterfly fish. You might not know exactly what species it will be, but you more or less know.
Right.
These are fish that are interesting for repopulation, or these are fish that are interesting for food fisheries, or so you need to start, you know, segregating them.
Right. And is this a first for the UK as far as we're aware?
No, because 20 years ago, I think 15 or 20 years ago, we were buying fish from French Polynesia and from the South Pacific that was post-larvae collecting. They didn't call it ranch at the time.
No.
But we were buying fish from these operations that were setting up. So in the more recent times, I don't know anyone who's doing it. So I would say yes. It hasn't been in the UK for a long time. We can't confuse this with growing juveniles, because there are certain times of the year you get a lot of fish at a certain size. It means that a couple of months before that species recruited, so the reef is now full of small regal tanks or small viliferum. Or, I mean, there are certain times of the year you get, you can get tinies. We sell them as tinies. We are still collecting juveniles, and we know where we're collecting at that point. So it's sustainable. I'm not saying it isn't, and it's still more sustainable than going in to collect an adult, a full-grown adult. Because predation, natural, predation of those species through their life cycle is so a lot of those species wouldn't survive to an adult. So if you collect an adult, it's really at the end of the line, so you shouldn't really be doing that. We're avoiding to do that. But it's not post-larvae rearing. It's not, so we have to distinguish that. So what people see in the industry, and I've heard that comment from a couple of people, I've had, we've been ranching them for years. I said, no, you haven't. Not in the concept we're trying to explain.
Different concept altogether.
It's a different concept. It's not right or wrong, it's just different. It is different.
And can we talk a little bit about what our goal is at the end of this? Because we want, I know we talked about the amount that we bring in. We're also looking at potentially not using all of those and giving back to the reefs.
Yes. So the giving back to the reefs is it's infancy for us. Because it's a lot more complicated than I thought it was going to be. Because it involves a lot of studies and a lot of techniques, which Ecocean and other conservation groups, but Ecocean primarily, has developed over the years, and it involves costs of setting up big structures. They call them bio huts, and you need to do that correctly. You can't just go in into a reef and the site's repopulated. So there's considerations to be had from a scientific point of view and from an ecological point of view that you need to take into consideration. So it's not just release it back. There's also, I've heard some concerns about imbalance of species. So if you take the cherry pick the ones you want, and then just release the ones you don't want, you're going to end up with a lot of stuff you don't want in the reef. I'm not sure how valid that is, because the ocean is a very, very big place, and what we're doing is very, very minor. So to unbalance the group of species that you have in a reef is, it'd be a lot of repopulating that had to be going on. But it's not an easy process. This is all to say that it's not an easy process. So, but the goal for me is to say, is to be able to say, for every fish that I take from the ocean, we're going to put two back in, three back in. Or I think the ratio is actually bigger than that, but it can be bigger than that, but it has to be done, correctly.
Correctly. Okay, so that'll take a little bit of time, but it's a concept.
It will, and it's different in each country, and it's different in each location as well. So, and you need support from local, fisheries, and you need support from funding as well. So, it requires a lot of effort. So, I'm sure we will be requesting some of that stuff, and getting people involved in raising some of that.
That's great. Either way, it's something to work towards, isn't it? So
Definitely. That's
a great goal. Well, thank you very much, Brian. I think we've kind of touched everything to do with managing that. As far as, you agree?
I think so, yes.
Okay, perfect. Well, I hope the viewers enjoy this and also the listeners for the podcast. And thank you for joining us.
Cool.